see familiar faces, I can also see new faces. So good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Asian Institute of Management, Dr. Andrew L. Tan Center for Tourism Lecture Series, Research Tourism and Community Development in Coastal Areas. So it's a warm welcome to our stakeholders and our partners in the tourism industry in advancing sustainable tourism here in the Philippines. So for your convenience, we have provided you with a kit. It contains blank sheets of paper where you can put your notes, the program flow, brief information about our center, and information on our upcoming capability enhancement program, the Designing and Developing Sustainable Tourism. If you need more sheets of paper and pencils, please approach the registration table, and we will be providing copies of the slides of Dr. Porter after the lecture via email. So make sure you have provided your email address. I think we have it in our database, but for the newcomers, please provide your email addresses with our registration. Now to get our lecture started, I would like to call on Mr. Terry Farris, Chief Operating Officer of the AIM Scientific Research Foundation, for the opening remarks. Growing up in Hawaii and spending most of his life on islands across Asia Pacific, Terry is passionate and strong advocate for surf tourism. Terry was involved with many ocean and ecotourism nonprofits and associations in Hawaii, California, Indonesia, Malaysia, Hong Kong, Thailand, and the Philippines over the last 30 years. In his professional career, Terry was the Chief Development Officer at Nanyang Technological University in Singapore. He launched and managed the Family Office Services for DBS Bank in Singapore, and he also launched the Philanthropy Services for MeSphere's Private Bank in UBS Philanthropy Services for Asia Pacific. Terry has been with the AIM Scientific Research Foundation since August of 2017. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a round of applause to Mr. Terry Farris.
Welcome, everyone. Dr. Porter, thank you so much. We have something in common. We both, she lived in Hawaii 10 years. I grew up in Hawaii. Sorry, I had to wear my aloha shirt because I felt it was much more appropriate because I, first of all, my picture was in a suit and I go, oh, this is going to be bad. So this was 2 weeks ago in Hawaii. I had my four kids, two were out surfing. And so for me, I love the ocean, I love surfing, I love ecotourism. We're very proud at AIM to have the Andrew Tan Tourism Center and the work that it is doing. And I think all of you come from the Tourism Center, and I think that this topic, you know, is very interesting. I mean, maybe you can talk about the mermaid topic, but you know, we'll talk about that later. But for us at AIM, we are celebrating 50 years here in the Philippines. For us, we've had the Zulich School on Development Management, looking at entrepreneurship, looking at ecotourism, looking at issues for many, many, many years. And so for us, livelihoods is very important. If you look at, we've just launched a new school on innovation, technology, and entrepreneurship here at AIM. So on the cutting edge of data sciences, we're looking at how data sciences can continue to impact the Philippines and across the region. So I want to welcome all of you here today. We're very, very happy that you've come. Dr. Porter, it is an honor to have you and to share your wealth of experience, and to all of our panel members who will be speaking, who bring huge wealth of experience. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you very much, Terry. I'm sure you made everyone excited about our lecture on surf tourism. Before I introduce our resource speaker, I would like to provide you first with a brief background of the Center for Tourism. So the center was established to deliver capacity building programs to conduct research and development, and to help in the tourism sector in advancing sustainable development. We are also into organizing programs, fora, conferences, and lifelong learning processes, and other scholarly activities to ensure sustainable tourism development in the Philippines. We have four major programming. One is the events and networking. We also have research and publications. And our focus right now is on the delivery of capacity building programs. So far, since the establishment of the center, we have delivered the designing and developing sustainable tourism, managing tourism development, tourism business planning workshops, and advancing tourism research, both for the public and in-house programs. In this coming February 2018, we'll be delivering again the designing and developing sustainable tourism. Likewise, since the inception of the center, we have already delivered three lectures so far. The first one happened in March 2013, wherein we discussed pertinent issues on the prospects and challenges in Philippine tourism. Followed by, in November 2014, in the midst of ASEAN integration, the center discussed tourism competitiveness in the Philippines given the upcoming or the ASEAN economic community that happened in 2015, or that started in 2015. And just last September 2017, the center was privileged to host Dr. David Newsom from Murdoch University in Perth, Australia, to deliver a lecture on the best ecotourism practices in Asia. But practically, he discussed what not to do in the ecotourism destinations here in the Philippines. We would also like to take this opportunity to acknowledge the presence of our partners and the different stakeholders in the Tourism Ministry of the Philippines. Thank you very much for coming. And ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce to you our resource speaker. Dr. Brooke Porter is an aquatic anthropologist. Her work focuses on coastal development and marine conservation strategy in lesser developed regions, with emphasis on surf and adventure tourism. She has worked in various capacities with NGOs, international aid agencies, and educational institutions. Dr. Porter worked in Maui, Hawaii for 9 years, serving as conservation director for Pacific Whale Foundation. She has worked on fisheries development projects in Eritrea with the United Nations. Dr. Porter has also worked in the industry as a naturalist aboard whale watching tours in both Hawaii and New Zealand. Currently, she is postdoctoral research fellow at the Auckland University of Technology in New Zealand and serves as scientific advisor to the Coral Triangle Conservancy. It's an NGO that focuses on reef protection and restoration in the Philippines. Dr. Porter is also a professor of environmental science at Umbra Institute in Perugia, Italy. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Porter.
Thank you for that wonderful introduction. Similar to what Terry said, I had to put a picture of me not dressed up nicely. This is actually from the Philippines, down in somewhere in the middle of the ocean outside of the Swanga Barong region. And that's my little newborn in the pouch. You can't quite see him there. I think he was 4 months old when I did that. That was some of my research. Is this mobile? Yeah, I might, if it's an option. I tend to move around a lot when I speak. So. If not, networking group just to help people advance the research, women working in marine Alliance, and REEF, Coral Triangle Conservancy. It's an organization in the Philippines that is doing some really cool stuff, working on destructive fishing, limiting that, the blast fishing, and also building bio-rock coral dome reefs. So, on we go. I'm going to tell you first a little bit about me. You got the professional introduction, but I'm American. I am from this place, right in the middle. So, as you can see, not a lot of ocean around there, and I kind of think that's the reason I got into the ocean, a little bit of rebellion. So, by the time I was 8 years old, I had declared my university major. I was going to be a marine biologist, and luckily my parents were supportive. By the time I was 13, we traded in the skis, because we used to go to the Rockies and skis, and I convinced them we had to go scuba diving, and this was just the only way forward. So that's me on the left when I think I was 13, and this kind of just sealed the deal that I was into it. I don't know if any of you guys remember that first time looking underwater, seeing all that stuff. So I became just dedicated to marine, anything, conservation, science, everything. And I ended up going to university in Florida, studying marine biology, so I held true to my declaration there. And when I did that, the year, it was summer before my senior year, I got an internship in Hawaii. And this is how I fell in love with Hawaii. It was on the Big Island, and my job was a field biologist for sea turtles. So all I had to do was go camping on these beautiful remote beaches. And at night, I just stayed up and looked for turtles. That was the job. And they sort of paid me to do that. It was like almost enough to eat. It wasn't a lifetime career or anything. So I thought this was great. This is my career. The daytime duties, it's hard to see here, but that's a mongoose I'm trapping. So, you know, marine conservation isn't all glamorous, right? We had to trap these mongoose and then kill them. That was my daytime duties. At night, it was a little bit better. But anyways, I fell in love with Hawaii, and as JP said, I moved back there right after I graduated and spent nearly a decade in marine conservation there. I also spent a decade falling in love with surfing. Yeah. There are a few other loves there, but it was just surfing. Everything revolved around surfing, and for anybody who surfs, like once it gets you, it really gets you. Work, love, everything becomes about surfing. You know, my job, it's like, do I have time to surf before work or after work? Okay, well, this job won't work. I need a flexible job. You know, boyfriends, do you surf? No? Okay, well, this probably won't work out. Or maybe you don't care. It just gets you. And there's even been some recent research to describe this transition through its this dedicated life phase. And we do grow out of it, unfortunately. Most of us grow out of it. There are some hardcore lifetime surfers, but for me, it's not everything's about surfing anymore because I have kids I have to take care of and I'm responsible for them. But anyway, it got me and it got me good, and you can see I'm still involved in surfing and surf tourism in some capacity. So, like I said, I thought I was going to live in Hawaii forever. This is Hawaii out there in the middle of the ocean, nothing around it except for really good surf. And then I fell in the other kind of love. I married an Italian, ended up in Italy. There's actually surf in Italy. It's not very good, but there's surf. So we were there, I don't know, a year or so, and then I started my PhD all the way down in New Zealand. We're down there. My husband got offered, he's also in fisheries and marine science. He got offered a job in the Philippines. And by that time, I had declared my research subject and just had to declare my research science. So I was looking at fisheries and supplemental livelihoods through tourism for coastal communities. So then we came up to Manila, and we spent 4 years here, from 2011 to 2015. I was based in Manila doing research. Both my children were born here, and the older one is now 5. He speaks so highly. He's so excited to come back to the Philippines for this trip. He even tells his teachers in Italy that he's Filipino. they look at him and don't worry about it. It was just torture. So he loves this place. He calls the Philippines home. So on to what I'm going to talk about. That's a little bit of a brief what started all this, and it got, I'll talk about it in a minute, but it ended up in surf tourism because I kept going surfing. So what I wanted to do was understand coastal communities, and I did this in 3 or 4 research sites. So I'll tell you about those, I'll talk about the findings, the models that came out of this research, and then I'm also going to talk about some ongoing research. This will be really helpful, I think, for the industry and places looking to develop surf tourism responsibly. And then, so, the first research question I have was, is marine tourism a viable option for coastal communities in lesser developed regions, namely fishing communities? Because a lot of these places, they're known for being poor, fisheries are degrading, and when fisheries become degraded, instead of moving towards marine conservation, they actually end up doing more destructive fishing. So they fish harder, and they fish more. So the idea for tourism comes from some previous research that's not mine, but just some references to the literature. And I think there's a reference slide on this presentation, so I'll try to make sure it's updated. Tourism is a viable poverty alleviation tool. We hear this all the time. Tourism is an alternative or a supplemental livelihood, secondary use of the resource. And what this means is for people who are fishermen, fisherwomen, they're comfortable with the marine environment. They have boats. They're used to going out. So this could be a really easy, theoretically, transition towards marine tourism. It has the potential to boost economies. And again, secondary use of the resource and overlap in equipment. So maybe they could use their fishing boats to take people snorkeling, to take people fishing, all kinds of ideas. And then also the final point, the community involvement. You can get communities involved through community-based tourism. So those were some of the ideas that founded this research. And what I set out to do was just sort of define coastal communities, and I wanted to get community perceptions on the state of the fisheries, because I wanted to see how they looked at their fisheries. Were they healthy? Were they degraded? Was it even a problem? I also wanted to understand how they identified with fishing. Did they like it? Did they think it was hard work? Did they want something else? And I wanted to know what they thought about tourism, right? Like, were they excited about it? Did they know about it? And tourism opportunities. What might be some options for these communities? And mind you, you guys all know the Philippines is gorgeous. There's beautiful beaches almost everywhere. So here's the thing. Endless amount of marine resources when you're looking at it through tourism. So the idea was to look at 3 points and a little bit of triangulation in the data, environmental, economic, social, cultural, and see how these added up. So Philippines, I don't have to tell most of you, but over 7,000 islands, that's a lot of islands, a lot of people, and unfortunately, like most places in the world, declining catches. So we're seeing our fisheries degraded globally. This isn't just specific to this region. And there's also, as I said before, once they become degraded, it's harder to catch fish. So what do? Instead of hook and line, you use dynamite or cyanide. So my first research site, within a few weeks after I arrived, was up in Bolinao in the Gaston region. And this was where I partnered with UPMSI. Then I went surfing, and I was in Zimbabwe, and then I went surfing some more down here. So those were my other research sites. The participants, the people who I interviewed, these are just the bad guys, Victory, Guinea Club, the Volvo, and they were all members of fishing households. That was to participate, they had to be a member of fishing households and be above 16 years of age. And just to explain, so Dimipak and Gigabobo, they're really near each other. That's why the numbers are so skewed. So it's about, 23 and 21. But they end up being quite different, so that's why we don't make assumptions in science, supposedly. And a little background on the participants. The education levels were relatively low, as is expected in coastal communities and remote areas. There was a lot more high school in Victory, which is up in Bolinao. Daily incomes were quite low. On the higher end, we saw people who were participating. participating in the live fish reef trade, so they're catching fish live, exporting them. It's much more lucrative than the sari-sari fishing. And then, to the exciting data, which is the numbers, the satisfaction of fishing. So if anybody, raise your hand if you consider yourself a fisherman or a fisherwoman. Anybody do fishing for hobbies? What? Anybody? Okay, I grew up fishing in lakes in the Midwest. Right. Well, a lot of people love it, and it becomes kind of an identity, and this is true for professional fishermen as well, fishermen. So when I asked them about this, this is an example of one of the responses. We're content with what we do. It's a source of living. We can fish, or we can farm any time. Fishing is part-time because of the season and the weather. Sometimes people ask us to transport fish to the main town with our boats, but we don't do it. Far. We're satisfied with what is here. So this kind of gives you an idea. I think motivation is they're just content. We do it, fishing, for a living. We don't feel like fishing, we don't. If we feel like fishing and there's a need to fish, and the season is right, we fish. It's something to do. So you begin to see the identity here and how you are as a fisherman. Maybe you don't have to do it all the time. Sort of like, I don't know, when you could organize your life around surfing, this might be a good occupation. So, I also looked at the factors that were influencing the satisfaction. And it was weather, catch, way of life, and then this idea of occupational control. So you can control when and where you fish. Even if you're indebted to somebody else or you're borrowing a boat, you still have say over that. You're still somewhat of an authority on how you fish or where you fish or when you fish. I also asked about willingness to exit the fishery, particularly towards tourism. And this top one, it took me a while to figure out what it meant because they just kept saying, I had translators because I'm not fluent in the dialects of the Philippines, the many dialects were in Tagalog. But they said good rules. That's good rules. Look, we kind of control it. We do it when we want. And if you're thinking about, you know, tourism, people who are going to go on a tour, they kind of want it to start at a specific time. So this could be a problem. You start to see where maybe tourism isn't a straightforward answer. They want to start whenever they feel like it. You know, then there were the obvious general improvement of standard of living, like uplift your livelihoods. Religious, there was this fatalism, like, oh, if God wills it, I'll do it. And only a few mentioned a declining catch, which I found to be surprising. There is, you know, it's very well documented in the scientific literature that fisheries are in decline. And some just said, you know what, I really like fishing, so there's that too. So feelings towards visitors. I also asked the participants, I said, well, you know, how would you feel if people came to your community? Would this be good, bad, what? So the tourism, this came from two elderly ladies in Kimibok. Tourism affects our community and culture. Most of the tourists go to the dance place in the community. They wear shorts, and the tradition is more formal. They should wear pants or skirts. But the young generation has changed. We see lots of foreigners wearing bikinis. Before, it's not too good to look at them. But now, it's commonplace. So this introduces a potential concern to tourism. You know, there's a little bit of culture because most people go to the beach, and a lot of people want to wear bikinis. So how do you manage this? And this has been documented in tourism literature elsewhere too. Other people said, ah, we feel nothing. Those are the white people. Those are the people who have white colors and we do not. It's like that. They're white, it's okay if they come to visit. So obviously there was this, in this response, this racial divide, but they were still willing to accept it. This is where it started to get interesting. You're happy because new faces come here. I've heard this over and over again. Have to remember, if you're thinking about a remote coastal community that's not well connected, there's no social media, Facebook, or if it is, it's through a shared cell phone. It can get boring, right? You don't have TVs, you don't have a movie, so what do? You watch the visitors. It's almost like entertainment. I ended up writing a whole book chapter on the social side, Starstruck Fisher Books, because they were so, well, we love these things. And so, Some say, you know, it's okay for them to come. We can marry a tourist. Jackpot, you get the dollars. These were some young men. So they saw a little bit of, you know, oh, maybe I can fall in love. I don't know. The visitors are beautiful. I'm happy and proud. We expect the unexpected. We think foreigners will help the livelihoods, they'll give us some projects, and uplift our economy and financial status. There are only a few foreigners come. And then again, we want to see new faces, new looks, a new color, and make new friends. In these barrios, we just look at each other. Every day, every time, it's the same face. So I was really surprised because I hadn't thought that maybe tourists would be the show for the locals. It's almost reversed from what we usually see. So this is just a quick summary of the feelings towards visitors from the data. You can see negative effects, indifferent, positive effects. There were a couple negative, and that was the two elderly ladies that talked about the bikinis. That was it. Otherwise, there were no risks from visitors identified by the participants, which is dangerous because there's a lot of risks when you develop an area. So indifferent, some of them went, eh, whatever, yes, no, maybe, don't care. Positive effects, this change of pace, that was seeing new faces. That's how that was coded. So you can see that's huge. 14, 39. Oh, I think pointers are there. So yeah, most of them were really excited about the idea of having people come. So then we started to look at perceived tourism opportunities. I came to visit with you, what did you show me? And I want to take a moment. I restructured that question because I said to start, like, what would be some potential opportunities for tourism? You know what? And again, I remind you, we're looking at, you know, the most pristine beaches. It's just paradise. But then I had to restructure the question because not, they were like nothing. Okay, what, if I came to visit again, what would you show me? Where could you take me? And that seemed to work a little bit better. So they would learn about different sources of income, not only fishing, but also other activities in the area. We're living in a barrio place, a small place too far from the municipal town. The fish, it's fresh fish, not spoiled fish. So there was a little bit of, you know, idea of the cuisine tourism or food tourism. And then I got a lot of this. I don't know. I'll introduce you to some people. Okay, well, I don't know. You know, if you're looking from tourism, will people pay just to meet a neighbor? I don't know. There's social tourism. Again, the people here are friendly and hospitable. If you come here, I'll show you our character and hospitality. It's a little bit vague, but still this idea of just show you around the neighborhood. This one was one of the, probably the most astute ideas. So we'll show you the wonderful Sea of Victory. We'll swim. We'll show you white sand, take you to a swim spot with a huge rock on an island. And then I ask, well, how do we get there? Like on the bath craft. At this point, the husband's wife was interviewing. She brought me over 3 cowrie shells and said, souvenir. So this was somebody who was kind of keyed in to tourism. I understood that, you know, I'd want to go swimming, see a beautiful beach. I felt this a few times, nothing. And I asked, you know, again, with this beautiful blue ocean and clean beach, how about the ocean? Nothing. We don't know the ocean. And this was in Higabobo. So Higabobo, there's a lot of indigenous community there. And they had some of the lower education levels and the lower exposures. Travel. So I didn't include it in this presentation, but I did ask the participants where they had been. And some of them hadn't left the place they were born. So it was a very limited worldview. So the tourists, they want to see the corals, but some parts are good, some parts are not good. This is the dynamite fishing. So again, you see, here and there, there's a few people that maybe understand this idea. I asked about the environmental impacts of tourism. I mean, we all hear about ecotourism, and it's really hard to do right. It's not straightforward. There's always some kind of impact. And with tourism development in these really remote places, we should be especially careful. So again, as you can see, no effect. Most of them thought tourism would be great. There'd be no effect. But we all know better. I mean, there's effluent. You have humans, you have human waste, and that has to be sorted. And be able to identify pros and cons if you're going to choose to move forward. Economic impact. I asked her, oh, you know, do you think it would help your livelihoods when you have more money? A lot of them didn't really see this economic impact. Again, they just referenced, oh, we get to see new people. They kept going back to this idea of looking at people. So, you know, likely there would be some economic benefits. Summary of these findings, there was a limited worldview, and this was due to quite a few factors: education, migration, travel, access, and exposure. So fishermen, fisherwomen, they don't travel like we might. They're not going to go for a week and trip somewhere. They're only going to travel for food or medical stuff. It's not a luxury like many of us have. So they're not exposed to it, and their access is limited because they are in remote areas. The other things, where there was a fairly high willingness to participate in tourism. Also, they're really satisfied with being fisher folk. So these two, this idea of willingness to participate and livelihood satisfaction, they contradict each other. If somebody's happy doing what they're doing, what's the likelihood that they're going to just take on a new job? So that was interesting. And then, like I just said, very few were able to identify risks associated with tourism. But we had this idea social benefits, like new faces. So next I want to talk a little bit about what social benefits are. They're not just limited to pretty things or a potential spouse. The social side of tourism. So we have seen new faces, but also when you have tourism in an area, language skills are often acquired. So you know, we've seen this in a lot of less developed regions. Their English improves mostly, but also other languages. And this is really beneficial to communities, because then they have this new skill that might make other things more accessible to them. They can get other skills, like surfing. It's really hard to see here. So that's my friend. This is also my friend, but it's what we like to consider the first Tacloban surfer. And friends. So you heard it in the responses from the participants. They said, oh, we get to, you know, we'll show you our neighbor. Meet new people. There's been research, these are some examples here, of how friends in lesser developed regions can increase your social status. And when the participants say, you know, we'll have new friends, it's not like you're really friends, maybe you connect on Facebook, but for them, they can drag to their other community members, oh, well, you know, I talked to the American girl that was here doing research, so it's something new. So it is a status symbol. And what I also found, the pride of place. So I heard this throughout the responses. People were saying, oh, we'd be proud. We'd be excited to share our culture or, you know, our fish. And I think that's really important. If you can get somebody to be proud of their place, they're probably going to be more willing to take care of it as well. All right, so this is just one of the first of many models that I'm going to show you. So I went into this research thinking community-based tourism. Let's get these communities involved. My research proposal even included participatory action research, which is where you do cycles of the community, get them together. But what happened is I found that the awareness was so low, so it wouldn't have been responsible of me to have a community come together and try to develop tourism. They couldn't identify the risks. I think that's a critical first step, is being able to understand the risks. So I just created this little model. It's this idea that here it's opportunistic tourism, seasonal, year-round. Basically, if you went this circle here, it'd be somewhere, a really well-developed destination like Hawaii, where it's, you know, tourism is the main economy. What we saw here is basically, we weren't even at this idea where it could be self-managed. So I had operative management dependency and if you're looking for community-based tourism, you need to be somewhere out here where there's some awareness, you know, there's the community is able to manage it, and it has to be at least seasonal. It wouldn't make sense for it to be just an opportunistic if it's this whole community effort. So then I ended up with a couple questions. My idea of participatory action ocean research and tourism development, I had to throw it away and say, all right, how can we take this unaware audience that doesn't really understand tourism and get them to meaningfully participate in tourism planning, development, and management? And I don't know if you can without doing a lot of education first. And, you know, this takes time, so if you're looking at trying to educate a whole community, take a while. So, I looked at other things. And communities with limited tourism awareness still benefit from tourism development. And this is where we get to the topic here. So, back to Zimbabwe, surfing, right? When I was there, I've heard now that it's changed very much. The last time I was there was 2011-2012. But when I went there, I stayed at the Circle Hostel. It was one of the only places there at the time. So, has anybody here stayed at the Circle Hostel? All right, we got one. Couple? Okay, cool. So, what do they offer? And this is where I found some unique things. And this is taken directly from their website. I just figured it'd be hard. A cozy common area, a chill vibe, comfy hammocks, banana and bread breakfast, friendly staff, and board hacks, and home tents. So, that's some stuff. But it's a very limited offering, right? They don't have anything more than banana for breakfast on offer. They don't have surfboard rentals, at least at the time they do. And you can see here, it's not like a full resort, right? It's a very simple accommodation. They also have this idea of you can volunteer, create a positive impact on communities, explore the Philippines, and learn other things. This idea of community development. And then I got this really complex model. This is what us scientists do. We like take something really simple and make it ridiculously complex. So you could look at it, and there's a full complication about it. But this here is the most important part. There was a gap in tourism services and infrastructure. So, and I talked to one of the founders, who's a key informant for my interviews. Or for my doctoral research. And this was purposely done not to offer everything, not to have a monopoly. So he left it up to the community to fill these other voids, like rentals, transportation, other food services. And it created these nearly immediate benefits, which is great when you're looking at tourism development. So the characteristics of this were social entrepreneurship. And my key informant, he had a social development background. And this was probably one of the most difficult things to argue in publications, is saying that somebody's altruistic. And you have to at some point. Like at some point somebody has to be good or has to be bad. But it's very subjective. So that's where this idea of social entrepreneurship comes in, where you can have a social entrepreneurial business and you can make millions, billions, whatever. But the idea is that you prioritize the community benefits, the social benefits first. And I think that's critical. And again, it's very subjective, it's hard to define, but the Circle Hostel was one of those places that was developed with intent of purposely creating a gap in services so that other people could pick them up and also benefit. It was small scale, it's not a huge place. If you've been there, it's like a place with no walls, it's not that big. There's literally no walls. And they also have environmental responsibility. They started early on with beach cleanups. And from what I understand now, it has progressed to almost a community-based tourism with the tribes and treks, and like going to the community and have help these other areas, which is great. That's perfect. But it's a little bit different than community-based tourism. I'll tell you later. Community participation was not compulsory in the development of it. The founder said, you know, at first there was some resistance with the community. They didn't quite understand this idea, but again, we go back to the idea of a social entrepreneur that's prioritizing social benefits. And that was what was really important. So in this paper, oops, I didn't put the reference there. We propose this idea, it's the same thing as social entrepreneurship, but also with an environmental component, and called it sustainable entrepreneurship tourism. Basically same thing, just making sure the environment is also accounted for. These are some of the interesting funds. I think this one right here is probably the most interesting for there's this private equity, and so people are putting their own money into the project. And if you're looking at, you know, aid agencies that are doing development work, I've worked on fisheries development projects in places I didn't have to put my own money in. You know, I'd love to see the project succeed, but I still get paid if it fails. If a social entrepreneur puts their money in and it fails, they lose. So there's this extra commitment to see your project to success. And then these are all really straightforward. You know, small scale is usually good. I won't get into it. There's some benefits from mass tourism, or it can be, but it's really hard. Basically, they just have more power. And if they're doing good, they can do more good. And then down here, we just have social entrepreneurship and environmental responsibility. So then, like I told you, I'm getting into all the models here. Sustainable entrepreneurship development timeline. So here you have a community with limited awareness. And here, this big circle here is the community that's meant to represent community benefits. And you can take two tracks. So you could start with social entrepreneurship tourism, and that's all you ever do, and that's fine. But like what we saw in the Bali's, then some of the community members could pick it up and you could turn it into community-based tourism. So it's a little bit flexible, this idea. So what does it look like? An example of where it just stayed as social entrepreneurship tourism is in Fiji. There's a shark reef marine reserve, and the operator there, he just bought the fishing access rights from the community. That seems, you know, a little bit of a takeover, a little bit colonial, but what he does is every year he pays it over. Percentage of the profits go back to the community, and it doesn't have to necessarily be, there's a minimum amount, so anything else goes back. And this was agreed on by the village, by everything. So not only are they getting economic benefits, it's also now a no-take area, a marine protection area. When you have a marine protected area, you have spillover, and all the fish get really healthy and happy, nobody's taking them, they reproduce, and then they go, they don't just stay in this block of ocean that's, you know, has imaginary boundaries. They go over everywhere. So community members here get money and they get more fish. So that's how we can see these social benefits come about. And then the other example is the one I've been talking about. It's a circle hostel. It'll continue on, but the community is likely to start picking up more and more tourism opportunities. It's really exciting. There's solutions, even if we have communities really low awareness. Now, I'm going to shift the discussion to talk about surf tourists. So, we know from what I've told you already that surf tourism can be done, especially looking at this entrepreneurial model. But, who do we want coming? I've been a member of a panel before, and the government was in Indonesia. They were really hesitant to develop surf tourism because of the reputation of surfers. This idea, you know, they're just beach bums, derelicts, drug users, hippies, kind of dirty. If you look at all the surf literature, it's quite the opposite. Those surfers are very affluent, they're very well educated, they're employed, and they spend a lot of money on surf travel. You know, looking back in my 20s, that probably wasn't true, but now I see budgets. So I would, this idea, what I'll talk about now, is how to target your surf audience. And I think this is good for the industry and areas looking to develop that might be a little bit more conservative, where you want to make sure you have a little bit of an older crowd. Turns out it's pretty easy to do. So this is the research team. It's me and a friend slash colleague who also surfs. There's a whole group of surfing academics. And proper organization and membership. You just have to be a surfer, an academic, basically. And we took a sample, a global sample of surf tourists. It was all online. You can see what color is Asia. It's the 11% right here. This was all Philippines. And that was the only country that responded, and it was because of some of my surf contacts here that I got them. Mostly Americans, Pacifica, Central and South America, and some Europeans too, the 21%. Oh, the number. That value was supposed to be 1. less than 1% from the Middle East. It was one surfer from Israel. We ended up with 198 valid responses. Demographics, mostly male. This was really common. Male, it's still a male-dominated activity. The average age of our respondents is 37 years, so not like 18-year-olds, not 22-year-olds. Over 70% had at least a bachelor's degree. Many have doctorates, master's degrees. 90% were employed. This is pretty good. Most of the 10% were students. I think there was only 3 or 4 that weren't employed or in between jobs, surfing too much. Most had a partner. And then you can see the income was relatively high. Over 60% were making $50,000 or more. And this is including all the lesser developed regions. So that was a pretty high average. 80% were intermediate to advanced surfers, self-identified. So most for short orders, and again, this is something to consider for the industry, the type of gear people are riding. You have to have it at the destination, or you have to transport it to the destination. And this little graphic here was preferred wave size. So this was waist time, overhead, double over. That had to be double overhead. This was head high overhead. So you can see most people were pretty satisfied with waves just here. It's not too big. And the annual surf travel habits. This was the amount people were spending annually on surf travel. You can see most people were 1 to 5,000 US. And again, over half were taking 1 to 3 trips a year. And then there were the super dedicated people that were 8 or more trips a year, just blowing it all. And to count as a surf trip, it had to be overnight or longer. So it wasn't just day trips. That's not included in this research. Key findings from this, what were that age and significant correlation between age and budget. So the older people were spending more, and this makes sense. We know as we get older, we hopefully become a little more responsible, can save money, do a little more surfing, get a nicer place. And then age was also linked to advanced planning. So people who are older were planning further in advance and were less likely to spontaneously travel for surf. Other key findings that was really interesting for us were that parenthood and partnership were really influential in the data. So parents, people, surfers with children, and people who were married or with a partner, there was a significant difference in their annual or in their surf travel behaviors. And we put this, it's in a publication that's under review, and I put the double asterisk there because, you know, this makes sense, and it's in tourism. If you have a family and then you're traveling more, so of course you spend more because there's more people. But what we found was that they weren't taking their loved ones along. They were traveling and they were spending more. But it wasn't because they were taking more people, they just had a, they were just spending more on themselves. So this, I think, is interesting for anybody in the industry. I highlighted this as preferred accommodation. So you can see here, possible homestay camping, surf camp, bed and breakfast, private rental, aka Airbnb, hotel, resort, all inclusive, we combine these. And then other included, like a van, staying with friends, just all different stuff, but there weren't a lot of others. So if you didn't have children, hostels were pretty appealing. If you had children, remind you, not just because you probably weren't taking your children with you, there's, you have these higher end stuff, private rentals or hotel resorts. So if you're looking at it from the industry perspective, you can basically target your audience. If you don't want young people in a destination, you know, don't put a hostel there. It's that simple, according to the research. And if you want a, you know, a more affluent, older audience, you just have higher-end accommodation. Basically the same thing for people who were married or had a partner versus single people. So again, if you're single, school, rough it at a hostel, just go surf. If you have a partner, maybe you bring them along, maybe you don't, but you still like this higher-end accommodation. and it was Link Page. So this, we also explore surf logistics, so different things that might be important for travel. So consistency, wave size, crowd, being able to bring your own gear, shore access to surf, water temperature, the availability of gear rental and repair, boat access to surf, and surf support staff. This idea of surf support staff meant like instructors or photographers. And this one up here is the most important. These were ranked 1 to 10, so closer to 1, the more important it is. And these are the average mean scores here. Consistency in wave size and crowds were basically the most important. And for anybody who surfs, that makes sense. Funny enough, a lot of people didn't care too much about water temperature. I mean, it was up there, it was in the middle, so it was of average importance, but not extremely important. And surf support staff is really low, which is, in an age of social media, okay, you think it's great to have somebody documenting you, but there's also the GoPro, there's all kinds of technology now where you can document yourself. So we didn't ask enough questions to make any of those assumptions. So summarizing this, we have consistency, wave size, and again, remember that preferred wave size was waist overhead, and crowd. Bring in your own gear for the tourism industry. This becomes really important because for anybody who surfs, it's very expensive to bring your surfboard places. It's ridiculous. You end up, you might spend, more than likely, it's better to buy one there. However, some airlines, this is from KLM, they have a new policy where a board equals a bag. So, cool, you know, maybe you just carry on your boardies, whatever, and then you check your surfboard and that's it. And I think this is something interesting for local airlines to explore. It might make people more willing to travel with it again, as long as they don't break it. That's another challenge of transporting surf gear. So those were some of that. We also looked at the destination. And again, up here is the most important. And again, accommodation. We talked about it with the other sets of data. Accommodation, value for money. So this idea, this is very subjective, but the idea that you know you're getting a lot, your money is going far. An environment and a healthy ecosystem. I think this speaks really highly for surfers and for marine air or coastal areas. The surfers are genuinely, there's been other studies to show this, concerned with environmental health. And you see these organizations, Surfers Against Sewage, Surf Rider Organization, it's global, it's huge. It's all about marine conservation. So summarizing this, accommodation is important, environment, food was pretty important. Food was number 4, and again, it's subjective, but if it didn't want to eat good food, it's entirely subjective. It wasn't a very well-designed question. But nightlife is not a priority. That was 2nd to lowest. Childcare was not a priority. So again, it just works to dispel that myth that surfers are revelers or party animals. You got good waves, you don't want to stay out all night to surf the next day. And as I said before, most people aren't traveling with their children, so childcare isn't a priority. And the last one here, the factors that were influencing surf travel decisions. There's been some other similar studies of motivations for travel. So we have getting away from it all. Again, subjective, but most of this stuff is. It'd be hard to objectify this. Being adventurous. Being able to improve your surfing ability. Fulfilling a dream, like, oh, I've always wanted to take this place off my list for surfing. Socializing with others, personal growth. Down at the bottom, you can see the lowest was participating in surf competitions. So this isn't very important. Most surfers seem to not be traveling to compete. And we did have professional surfers in our sample, so there was a few that did, obviously. So most important, let's just get away from it all, this idea of escaping, and fewer traveling for competitions. So this is my last slide, and then I'll welcome any questions. But some of the key things I want you guys to be able to take away today are that surf tourism, it can be aligned quite easily social and sustainable entrepreneurship models are available. Like I said, it's really simple. It's just leaving a gap in tourism services. You can use that very complex model where you can remember that as long as you share the wealth, that's one of the most important things. And the second part of what I spoke about today was that the family life cycle is extremely influential on surf travel behavior. So as people get older, they have different accommodations, they're spending more. But what we did find, and I didn't include it, they're still taking the same length of trips, or the same number of trips, and staying for the same amount of time. That doesn't seem to change at all. So for destinations trying to get people to stay longer, it's probably something nobody really knows what's influencing that yet. And with this, the destinations can potentially control their audience. And again, this becomes important for remote communities that haven't had this high level exposure. If they're okay with noise, cool. They can have that younger crowd that might stay up a bit later, but if it's a more conservative culture, it might be better to look at higher end accommodations, like private rentals or all-inclusive surf camps that target a more mature audience. So that's it. This is my work email up here. I have a website. All my publications you can download there. So they're all available as PDFs. If you have any questions, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Porter, for sharing your expertise with us. Now, please hold your questions for Dr. Porter for a while, because I would like to invite you for coffee break. And I would have to change the time in the program, because we finished quite early. Please be back at the case room by 3 o'clock for our panel discussion. Then after the panel discussion, you'll be able to... I want you to have more time to ask Dr. Porter questions. So we'll do it after the coffee break. You can also ask our panelists later for your pressing questions. So snacks are served outside. Any refreshments outside. We're going to begin with our panel discussion. I hope your questions for Dr. Porter and our panelists are ready. Your pressing questions are ready. Now, but before that, you will find feedback forms on your table. We would request that you accomplish them, and we would appreciate your comments and recommendations to improve further our programs in the future. Now, once you have accomplished it, kindly submit those feedback forms to the registration table later after the program, or you may approach any one of the organizers. Okay, is everybody in? Okay, to begin our panel discussion, I would like to introduce our moderator. The moderator would be our center's research coordinator, Ms. Ada Gutierrez. Ms. Gutierrez serves as an intern for the National Green Growth Policy and Green Local and Regional Economic Development under GIZ. She also had her internship at the Konrad Adenauer Stiftung, and she obtained her Bachelor of Arts in International Studies, majoring in European Studies from De La Salle University. And she's also taking her Master of Arts in Development Policy from the same university. But ladies and gentlemen, our moderator for the panel discussion is Ms. Gutierrez.
So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is a privilege today to be the moderator for today's panel discussion. I am delighted to sit next to our distinguished speaker, Dr. Porter, and our esteemed set of panelists. So, before we start, allow me to call on each of our panelists so that they may proceed in front. So may I call on first, Ms. Maren Obispo from the Department of Tourism. Mr. Joey Cornelio from Philippine Surfing Academy. Attorney Mary Ann Cusillo Sering, formerly from the Climate Change Commission, and of course, so now I'm more than excited to discuss with them, and of course with everyone here, the Philippines' booming surf tourism industry. For years now, the Philippines has seen the growth or the development of its tourism industry and how important it has become in steering economic growth and development of the country. Now, we see that in the Philippines, given our topography with over 7,641 islands surrounded by large bodies of water and a delightful tropical climate, It is to no surprise that surfing spots such as the ones in La Union, Baler, Chagao, among others, abound the country. And surfing, unarguably, has become one of the world's fastest growing personal sport, where the Philippines is slowly becoming the next surfer's paradise. Now, given this situation, a discussion among experts such as this has become imperative. Now, before I start on the discussion proper, I would like to discuss how we will run so as to ensure that we maximize the time that we have. So each of the panelists will be given 5 minutes to comment on Dr. Porter's discussion. They may add on some insights from their perspectives. They will be given the floor in the following order. The first one would be Ms. Mario Obispo, followed by Mr. Cornelio, and then finally, Attorney Mary Ann Luzconsiri. Afterwards, we will be asking Dr. Porter to give her further insights to expand the exchange of ideas. And finally, I will be opening the floor, of course, for questions from the audience. So now to formally open the discussion, may I call on our first panelist, Ms. Marian Obispo. So Ms. Marian Obispo is the Senior Tourism Operations Officer from the Manpower Planning and Monitoring Division of the Office of Industry Manpower Development of the Department of Tourism. She previously held positions in the department as Tourism Officer number 2 for the Office of Tourism Standards and Regulation and the Team China Marketing and Promotion and Accreditation Division. So let us all welcome Ms. Mary Ann Martin.
Good afternoon, everyone. So actually, I'm very much honored to represent our Undersecretary Catherine De Castro. So I'm here to represent her because of an emergency meeting in the office. But then, actually, based on the presentation by Dr. Porter, so she all mentions about, of course, the social entrepreneurship. No? My comment is about that I'd like to share on the government's activities, and then what is the share? Because actually, in order for us to attain this surf tourism, the social entrepreneurship, there's a big role that will come from the government, hand in hand with our local government units. I'd like to share for the DOT side, with the help of our LGUs. So we're doing, actually in 2014, we had a public consultation for all the, we've identified surfing sites in the country, such as the Siargao, we have the Baler, Dayt, Tamarindis Norte, and then we also had a consultation in Zambales as well. So the result of that consultation is that there is really a need, no, to professionalize our surfing instructors. That's why the DOT comes in, that aside from giving them training, no, the DOT initializes trainings to our local surfing instructors. We aim for them to have to be certified internationally. No, so we have a partnership with the Academy of Surfing Industry of the Philippines, which is international certified by ASIM. I'm so sorry. I'm a little bit nervous because I thought I'd sit there in the panel. I got caught in the app. Although, so that's why actually there's a lot of activities that's been doing by the DOT. And I'm very much fortunate because I'm one of the project officer in doing this, because we really aim that the surfing instructors in the country, because of course surfing tourism is already emerging in the Philippines, and that's why we have to bear in mind also that in order for us to have a sustainable tourism, so we have to educate our surfing instructors. So with that, the DOT also will, actually we're developing a standard for our surfing camps, schools, as well as the surfing instructors. So it's for them to be professionalized. Actually, there's an instances actually, it's a true story, wherein the surfing student was saved by the surfing student saved the surfing instructor, because the surfing instructor doesn't know how to swim. And based on our study, most of our surfing sites, we have a lot of surfing instructors that doesn't have the BLS, the Basic Life Saving Seminar, and the WASR, Water Safety Rescue. That's why the DOT comes in. We need to professionalize them, because safety is very important. So we always tell to our surfing sites that if there will be one problem or one accident that happens, so what will happen to your surfing industry? So it will gone out. So that's why there's really a need also to educate, you know, our local peoples, the tourism awareness on the importance. Because actually, very unfortunate that there is some in our surfing sites, you know, the mentality of our local people, because most of them really are fishermen. Their mentality is, as long as they have visitors, it doesn't matter to them at all. So they don't want, the DOT is coming to them, we're giving free training to them. But then they do not give any importance. So that's why, that is the reality. And this is a big challenge that we're facing, and we need really the cooperation of our NGOs. So that is all that I can share for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Marian, for that insightful perspective coming from the public sector, specifically that of the Department of Tourism. Now, of course, to complement this, we'll be having an esteemed panelist from the private sector. So we have Mr. Joey Cornelio. Mr. Cornelio is the operations manager of the day-to-day activities of the Philippine Surfing Academy. From the surf lessons held in the wave pool to the out-of-town trips to the local surf spots near Manila. He has been surfing since 2014, right after he left his job in the medical supplies industry, and has continued to help educating Manila-based surfers in becoming stronger and smarter surfers. Let us welcome Mr. Cornell.
Hi, good afternoon. So, like Ms. Marian, kind of nervous, so I thought I was sitting here. But yeah, I'll just give a little perspective from the surfing instructor regarding surf tourism development. Primarily on the challenges and the benefits that we will have when this thing goes full on. As we know, like the surfing industry in the Philippines is fast booming. Back when it started in 2011 or probably earlier, it was just a little few surf spot around Manila, little known to surfers. Now it's becoming a full trend with direct flights going to Siargao. Now, it's beneficial for us surfing instructors, because it's going to be our income. However, there's also going to be like challenges. Since it's fast booming, I don't think that a lot of the surfing instructors can handle the number of students who are interested in surfing. Aside from that, there's also a few number of surfers or a few number of people really interested in getting serious in surfing. Some of them are, some people who try to learn surfing are mostly bucket listers trying to cross up surfing from their list. So that's a little dangerous. Our role in the Philippine Surfing Academy is to filter those bucket listers from the serious surfers. Our concern primarily too is safety. When we teach beginners to surf, we stress on the safety when they go to the beach. We want to make sure that they know how to properly swim and how to handle the surfboard or to how to properly surf. In that way, they won't be included in the casualties of accidents, number of things that happen in the ocean. Aside from that, we also want to stress environmental care. As surfers, we have a responsibility of taking care of the environment. And it's sad to say that with the fast booming of the surf industry, it's also evident that a lot of the surf spot near Metro Manila and further north, or some in the south, there's already trash littered in the ocean. There's also like the plastics and everything. So I would say that if we're gonna like develop surf tourism, I would want to stress on the environment first.
year.
I'm going to be honest that we'd rather slow down surf tourism for the reason that we want to develop first the infrastructure by the local LGUs in the local surf spots. We want to make sure that they're prepared to handle the influx of tourists coming in. We want to make sure that they have proper sewage system. We want to, before teaching surfing, of course. I mean, of course, it will go back to us as instructors. Our primary livelihood would be coming from the ocean. And if this won't be properly managed, properly handled, of course, the environment would be wasted, trash littered in the ocean. There won't be any more room to teach surfing because tourists won't be able to surf trash littered ocean, right? So for now, that's just what I'm gonna share.
Thank you, Mr. Fernando, for the interesting insights coming from the perspective of the private sector of a surfing instructor. So now to complete our roster of panelists, may I call on Attorney Lucille Siring. Attorney Siring served as the Undersecretary in charge of legal and finance of the Department of Environment and Natural Resources from 2007 to 2010. As Undersecretary for Legal, Attorney Siring was chosen as one of the three non-Supreme Court members of the Technical Working Group headed by Supreme Court Justice Renato Puno. That crafted the landmark environment rules of the Court of the Philippines. Appointed as Commissioner of the Philippine Climate Change Commission in 2010, and eventually appointed as Cabinet Secretary under the same office from 2011 to 2015. Now a practicing lawyer and a member of the board of Smile Cares Foundation Incorporated. From the province of Surigao del Norte, may we welcome Attorney Siring.
The benefit of speaking last is, you know, that if the two of the speakers are nervous about staying there, so I would decide to just sit here and be beside our speaker and be more intimate and lessen the impact of the fear. I would like to comment first on the slides that were presented by Dr. Porter. They were, first the sampling, obviously. It would be interesting to know how much of that would actually represent the whole universe of a surfing community. And I noticed also that the areas where you had your research, interestingly, are on the left side of the western part of the country, where the emerging surfing communities are now mostly on the right side. Samar, especially Siargao. And we know that everybody's talking about Siargao. We have a movie about Siargao, but there's so much about Siargao that we need to know that actually represents what could be a small part that represents a bigger problem down the road if we are to pursue surfing as part of tourism, a menu of the Philippines. So looking at the sampling, there were interesting questions that were also part of our questions of ordinary individual, and we're very happy, and we'd like to thank you for that, that you validated some of them through your research, and we can, you know, it's always good to be relying on data that has validation rather than what you call based on hearsay and cuento. Talking about hearsay or stories and sharing of stories from an old lady to a young one, let me look at also the perspective of why is there an attraction of surfing tourism in the first place when we never knew about it. I grew up in Surigao del Norte. I spent a lot of my summers in Siargao. My father used to be governor there. We used to be very afraid of this place called General Luna. The reason why, the waves are too big, they're too loud, and you know, it's a godforsaken place. Nobody wants to build a road there because nobody wants to go there. So that's cultural, and that's something we should start to understand. And then the next is, there we go, here we are. Siargao now is, and General Luna is in our mouth. And we are all concerned, especially us locals. Why? When you look at the questions, interestingly, how do you resolve a problem like Siargao, which is similar to other surfing areas? Surigao used to be in the poorest province until mining boomed. The reason why we all wanted to succeed as an environmentalist is we want to show proof that tourism is the best alternative to exploitative businesses like mining. Because if you look at Siargao now, Surigao del Norte as a province, the moment you go around the surfing area, you will see a whole bunch of large tracts of mountains that have already been stripped of their minerals. So there is now another part where exploitative provides a huge chunk of economic benefit. And here comes now Siargao Island, which is actually a protected area, landscape, and seascape. The problem is I heard about infrastructure. What kind of infrastructure are we talking about? You're talking about the connection between social entrepreneurship and surf tourism. They are actually, should be treated as one. Any business that are truly surf tourism is a social enterprise. Because you cannot have a good social enterprise in surfing tourism without considering the environment. So when you go there now in Siargao, people are like, oh, I love Siargao, it's so chill. I want to know why that kind of feeling is a tourist attraction in itself. So buildings and infrastructure should be built around the chill vibe. Because number one in your life is people want an escape. I don't want to be in Siargao and it feels like Manila. So it is really very much a problem of government. And I actually don't blame the local government. And I have to say it to those who go there and feeling like self-righteous. Oh, Siargao had bad sewage system. Oh, basura everywhere. We were fine before you all came. You used to drop it off in the ocean with just 1 or 2 or 10 people. It probably won't matter. You know? We, in fact, that's at the time. But now the problem is because you're all coming and you're all demanding from a local government whose awareness on tourism is limited to who can come here, a new face, and I'll buy from your sari-sari store, and then a sari-sari store have more income, and then more income means more money for the local government. Unfortunately, that's how local government think. So looking at that, is that I hope you would scale up a research such as this, because we're talking about a US $1 billion industry. If we can get just a small portion of that, let's say 50 million, that's 2.5 billion pesos. That's more than enough to look at in terms of investment on infrastructure from the local government perspective, business from the surfing academy, and for all of us who are there who just don't want to be disturbed when people start coming in. I want to retire there. I will have to really be more involved. But if tourism is there, for me, it shouldn't be the main attraction. Because you're just in that one part of the ocean anyway. So the main focus is should be on the entirety. And Tiesa is here. I'm talking not just about Dr. Porter's slides, but on the national government who needs to be more involved because we have a gem there, you know, in Siargao. And it, and whatever works in Siargao can also work in other country. I hope that, and one question I had earlier with Dr. Porter is in her slide, she mentioned about community participation not being compulsory. I just want to be, you know, you could elaborate with the answer and you could understand because community-based tourism should be connected to surf tourism. So thank you.
We break the formality and let's just all stay in this so everyone feels comfortable. So now, of course, we're all interested about Dr. Porter's comments and further expand this.
Thank you, because those were really wonderful comments. As you can see, there's a ton of issues with tourism development. And I think, for me, that was one of the biggest findings with all this research, is that it's so complex and it's so difficult to do it well. First, I'm going to answer the question about community-based tourism and compulsory and non-compulsory participation. That sounds really bad and really dangerous, and I had a really difficult time defining this. But again, if we go back to the idea of social entrepreneurship, it's based on the idea, the subjective idea, about altruistic individuals trying to better a community. And the idea that you might be in a situation where community-based or community participation is not compulsory, was founded from the research sites where these communities, they really had no clue about tourism. And nothing against them, it was just, that's the realities. But community-based tourism requires meaningful participation. And I think too often that's overlooked. Like, I could have probably gotten those community members in a room and gotten them to agree with what I was saying. But that's not ethically responsible. And I think too many times we have community leaders doing that, saying, oh, you know, they see the money, they see the opportunity, so here's, they make open promises, and it's very difficult, and maybe there's a better solution than social entrepreneurship tourism right now. Personally, I haven't come across one, so it's difficult. It's the idea of putting your faith in somebody to do good and do it well, and it can go well, it can go poorly, and we run into risks all the time. So that's when I refer to it not being compulsory. The example I gave of the Shark Marine Reef Reserve in Fiji, that was an example where it's been ongoing for, I think, nearly a decade now, very successfully. The community's happy. It's limited development because the access rights were purchased, a marine reserve was created. So it's one solution. It may not be the best solution, but if we're going to do community-based tourism effectively, they have to have an awareness. So that starts with education programs, which are really time consuming. If you're looking at a place that has, you know, degraded fisheries or degraded coastal ecosystem, and perhaps tourism is one of the quickest, most effective supplemental livelihoods, you may not have time for the education. So it's a whole game of balancing pros and cons, and it's not straightforward. There's not a single answer. So I hope I've answered it in that capacity. So yeah, it'd be great if we could get communities to participate, but we have to be very respectful in doing that and making sure they really know what they're agreeing to, because otherwise it goes downhill really fast.
So it's more of the statements, more of subjective. It depends on the quality of your participants, whether they should be part of it or not. Because if it's zero awareness, you're saying is it might not be good to bring in there. And hopefully that some champion will just come in and do it right. But if, oh, okay, so I understand.
It's challenging, always. So, and what about you guys? I know I wanted to comment on something, the infrastructure as well, when everybody referenced that. So specifically with surf tourism, if you have human effluent in the water and you get a cut surfing, this becomes very dangerous very fast. You have high incidences of staph infection. So I think this is where it's going to be important for the government to step in and really require these types of infrastructures, because if you have tourists coming, surfers, and they're getting sick in the water, they're not going to come back. It's going to be a one-time thing. And so it's more of a health risk. So I don't even know, maybe you bring in the Department of Health on this to include them in the development as well.
So thank you, Dr. Porter. So as we continue this brief discussion, you would see that surf tourism is actually a double-edged sword. On one hand, it can provide enormous opportunities for economic development, for improving lives of communities. But on the other hand, it can also have impacts, negative impacts, on not just environment, but also on culture, and also may distribute benefits unequally. Now, I know in the faces of the people here in this room, I know that you have been holding in some of the questions that you have ever since Dr. Porter's discussion. So right now, I would like to open the floor for any questions from our audience. So given our time, I would like to, of course, remind our guests to please state your name and the organization to which you belong to, and also have your questions delivered in a concise manner. Do you have any questions? Okay. Ms. Debbie.
Good afternoon. Debbie Tan, Palawan Tourism Council. I'd just like to find out where can we let the ball start rolling? Will it be the private entrepreneur or the government? For my thinking, no, I think it should be the government, because as you have said, Dr. Porter, that these coastal communities are not that educated, not that aware, unless there are some scrupulous beach lot owners that, you know, are aware, no? But then again, to prevent all of this runaway development and whatever environmental degradation that may happen, I think it would be DOT who should be doing the initiative. For example, I have my nephew here, he's also a certified surf instructor, but as he was saying, there is no support. In other countries, if you have, surfing, like in Australia or whatever, there is a real government support, such as, backing of the government as some sort of allowance or something, and promotion, you try to help them in teaching, in making the surfing sport develop, well-known and all that, So maybe a bit of promotions and, of course, standardization. Standardization of instructions, of instructors. Right now, everybody, I think the mode is they get an instructor from abroad to instruct them to be certified instructors. So why can't we have later on local instructors to certify certain instructors here also locally in the Philippines? So that one, and also make aware for mga municipalities who are already more or less developing that kind of tourism to start developing their own plans. So would you agree that DOT should start it?
Actually, ma'am, DOT has already started it. But maybe for Palawan, kasi it's not yet, actually it's already in the pipeline, supposedly last quarter of this year, we will have a training. Actually, we started it in 2014, we've done consultations, so together with the Surfing Association, surfing instructors, and then resorts or surfing camp schools, because the DOT plans to develop an accreditation standard. So we will accredit surfing camps or surfing schools, no? Plus then, of course, we're developing a standard also to accredit the surfing instructors. And then, in line with that, so while we're developing the standard, although we're planning, hopefully, the standard will be finished by next year, in line with that, we're doing a simultaneous training. Because during our consultation, we found out that there's a need to educate, no, to give trainings to our surfing instructors, because number one issue is the safety. Aside from the professionalism, and then we really want to be at par, actually, in the world, no. So that's why the DOT had partner with the. Actually, it's ASIP. So before we had a partnership with them, so ASIP is they are the only internationally recognized here in the Philippines. That's why the DOT has partnered with them. But the DOT is open to other associations as long as they are internationally certified. Because we wanted our surfing instructors to be internationally recognized. So in 2015, we had a training. We conducted training, pilot runs, to our surfing sites. So as I've said earlier, we had a training in in Daet, Camarines Norte. We also had a training in Mati, Davao, in Zambales, in Siargao. And then it's in the pipeline. Although, La Union, Baler, there's a huge number of surfing instructors there, but then there are some political issues also in the surfing industry. That's why the DOT wasn't able to talagang come in totally, no? But we're telling to the local people that do not see it in a way, in the perspective of the person who will conduct the training. But they have to see what will be your benefit, no? What will you become after this training. The DOT is paying for that. We're conducting surfing trainings to them. Actually, we had trained 115 surfing instructors, And then after that, the training, they will be certified to level one. So that's the DOT initiatives that we're doing, and it also being continued by this year. So hopefully we'll do it in Balerna and then in La Union, as well as actually Palawan. So we've gathered the data that there's a surfing spots in Palawan. And I'd like also to share that we also, because I am formerly with the Standards Development Division. So right now, in the Industry Manpower Development, we're planning to have a project also for the Philippine Youth Program. So we're proposing to have this project a continuous one. Kasi before, it's a parang pilot. So it will be the OT who will train you first. But after that, once the standard has been set up, so parang it will be on the PACS account or at the expense of the surfing instructor. So that's why we're telling to the local people na grab the opportunity. Parang leave the ego, pride what's in there, no? So try to get what will be the benefit, not for your own good, but for the whole community. That's where I know. So that's why actually one of the important issue also is the LGUs. They really want talaga the DOT to come in because there's a lot of surfing instructors, habal-habal, drivers, no, doing the surfing lessons. So they really want DOT to regulate. They're telling us that we cannot apprehend them because there's no law, no? So that's why hopefully we're targeting that by next year that the standards will come up. So for example, these surfing camps or surfing schools or even the resorts, if they offer a surfing lesson, they need to hire only the DOT or certified surfing instructors. Otherwise, it will be they will be apprehended or there will be a sanction.
So, follow up lang. So, right
now, the existing ones should still get a license from you later on.
Right now, there's none yet because we're still developing the standards. But the DOT is starting to really to encourage our local people to grab the opportunity if the DOT offers the training. So, kasi it's a limited slots. But of course, we want to make it sustainable as well kasi we know that our surfing instructors naman, they don't have really their money, no, to pay for the expenses ng certified. But what we need lang for them, and of course, there's a big we need a big cooperation from the LGU side because they are the one who touch base or who touch base with our local people. Kasi before, actually, we had trainings that BLS and WASAR is a prerequisite before they can be certified. But unfortunately, there are surfing instructors, they were trained, free training for the BLS, free training for the WASAR, and then we had them trained, but they were not certified for the reason that they did not finish their training courses. So Red Cross did not certify them. So it's sayang, no? The efforts of the government. So sabi nga namin, it should be a two-way relationship. So it's not every time it's DOT or the government will give. So we hope that the local people, through the help of our LGU, talaga should really realize the importance and then the opportunity that we're giving to them.
Is there a representative from Marco Polo?
Hearing the box, I think we have a you can imagine the past potential that our Philippines can open to everybody. So it being a 7 times larger, our territorial water, than our landmass, then there must be something in it that we can, that we benefit everybody. I guess, just like in other business, we have varied interests that we have to seek common ground so that the interested party will have equitable share. And at the same time, make business of business as a segment of tourism a sustainable one. Now, I would like to believe that surfing as a segment of tourism is still evolving and developing. It's in developmental states. So we have to start it right. We don't want to see the same story just like what happened in our famous pictures here, because we often in our desire to propel that, to push the development, we somehow neglect the side of respecting the environment. This is my question. Having identified the stakeholders, I suppose we already know the stakeholders of this segment of tourism, this dream. Do we have now a master blueprint for this, or a sort of a roadmap that will set us a guide for everybody so that our efforts will be coordinated and will be logical and will be something that this industry will progress the way it should be, and something that we should be proud of in the future. So basically it's the roadmap, and who is gonna take the captions for this industry?
Thank you for the question. So as we've heard over and again, the Philippines is in its infancy in surf tourism development, and this is a really unique place to be because you can manage it. As all the surf data will show you, surfers don't like crowds. So you don't really want to get that big. If it does, then it's not going to be that important. There's different ways in tourism to manage things. As an example, in Hawaii, for tour snorkel operators, that people taking, or operators taking people snorkeling, there's a limited number of permits, and you can never create more permits. Only sell the permits. It's one way to do it, but it's really helped manage the snorkel sites. You know, surf tourism, it's a little bit different. There's shore access. You don't necessarily need a permit in a dock, any of that stuff. But it's something the government should look to, different strategies for controlling crowds. For beginners, the bucket listers, it's not a big deal. They want to do it once, maybe twice, and that's it. But for serious surfers, once a place gets crowded, you don't go there anymore. And so, the Philippines is in a critical place figuring out a strategy to manage the potential economic benefits, which usually make people develop really fast, or the long-term benefits. And I think the blueprint has to be a very long-term strategy where sites are managed, there's limits on visitors, there's limits on developments. So that's probably more your area. Those are just suggestions.
I agree with you, sir. I think there should be really, as of now, honestly, there's no roadmap yet for the surfing, because before, actually, promoting surfing, particularly Siargao, has been there for how many years already. But then, the problem is, there's a lot of promotion that's been done, but the infrastructure and then the readiness of the local people, as well as the surfing instructor, it's a little bit too late. No, and then the regulation, the standards, no, that is already also lacking. So maybe it's high time. It's a good suggestion that there should, if there's a MICE industry roadmap that's going on, maybe the OT can start off to have a surfing industry roadmap as well. Because we really want to, because it's an emerging market, and then there's a lot of destinations, potential areas for the surfing industry in the Philippines.
because we know what roles are being played by each one. The tour operators, if there's a lot of interest, you just package it and bring them there. And then you have the role of the local government, for example, was practically overwhelmed suddenly. And she's correct, most surfers don't like crowds. If you look at the tourist arrivals in Shandong now, you'll be surprised, 95 or 96% are non-surfers. So we're talking about the surfing industry, which is basically just an entertainment for the 96%. So there's an opportunity in the 96% whose infrastructure is really the one we should prepare for when we're talking about surf tourism, when the infrastructure is really not much in terms of need. Because most of the surfers would like it the way it is, you know, less crowd, as long as there's a clean toilet, they'll survive. It's a culture. We are missing somehow that the surf tourism, if it's big, it's really the non-surfers that is the market. So it's true that the national government, DOT, just promotes. No, coming from government, but their main mandate is promote. Whether there's an infrastructure or not, they will promote. In fact, there's also a disconnect. Even our local government even made a movie out of Siargao, promoting the sites of Siargao, when Siargao cannot even accommodate the arrivals of tourists. So why? So why is it so? So if there are statistics such as this that are made available and scale up the sampling and put it in the development plan of a local government, then this is where it should start in terms of moving forward. We train as many surf instructors as we want to. Most of those who are surfing in Siargao are no longer going to school. The social entrepreneurship should also look at the social issues of what this is all about. We will never understand it if we're not a non-surfer, or if we're not a surfer. We will never understand why it's an attraction now to have tan skin and buff bodies. Because, you know, we're way past our prime, most probably. But there is an opportunity for the 96% non-surfer. We're talking about thousands of arrivals. They're complaining, oh, I can't go to Siargao because Siargao is expensive. But I feel it's actually a benefit for Siargao because the more people can afford it, you can actually regulate it. And now we're talking about an international airport. Why? So I hope their TSA is here, talking to you. It's actually a good friend of mine. And by the way, the governor of Surigao is a cousin also. So and she understands the problem. And Kiesa, the OT who are here, since you're there, please, it's an appeal. You know, to be more aggressive and to be more aware of ourselves, because these are players that are already organized that are willing to bring in the right kind of tourists if they can package it correctly. And we already have that structure in place. So all we had to do is prepare. So talking about development, then that's the right kind of guy you should talk to. Okay? I put him on the spot. Tiesa, by the way, not a lot of people know about what Tiesa is. Maybe you could explain, Attorney Lusada, putting you on the spot. They are actually sort of the government corporate arm, is that correct? But doing investments for DOT. They handle the infrastructure. They provide that funding for areas like San Vicente. Even Siargao, when I was Commissioner of Climate Change, we declared this an eco town, primarily to veer away from surf tourism. That was the idea, is to have an alternative to surf tourism, because that's not what Siargao is all about, only. So I have my niece here, she's into yoga. So I have a friend here, she's into agriculture. We all want to do something in Siargao, not surfing, because we saw the 95%. So for all the tourist operators, take note. There are a lot of arrivals there that are non-surfers, but they don't know where to stay. And the crowds are really bulked up. So interesting statistics that we all want to use. Eventually, if you don't mind, if you can share those with us. Thank you.
I'd like to recognize, actually, we're very fortunate, the presence of our regional director from DOT Region 13. So Director Nagy, she's here, and also the regional director of Region 5, Director Santiago. They are here. So if for Region 13, you'd like to share something about your grandma?
Keep on talking about Region.
By the way, I'm Director Maria Ana Tilogip from the region of Calaga. And I'm the new director for that. You keep on talking about Siargao, and that is under my region. And I wanted to keep you an update regarding my Siargao, no, specifically, because I've been there for 2 days, Saturday and Sunday, because of the Tourism Philippine Board, who went there for a visit or for a tour. Siargao is a capital. It's a surfing capital in Asia, no? And you cannot only the surfing is already established in Siargao because we have major events held in Siargao, which is in April the game fishing internationally participated by local and foreign, no? And then we also have a surfing for women cup to be held on May, and then the most awaited was the surfing International Surfing Cup for men held every September. So those three major events in Siargao was funded by Department of Tourism. And in fact, we allotted 33 million budget for this coming Surfing Cup International for this coming September of 2018. So the part of DOT is to really establish and promote the surfing international cup all over the world, no? And it was successfully participated by a lot of foreigners. And surfing is not only the place in Siargao. We have a lot of destinations located, no? So surfing is established already, and some other destinations are Sumba Lagoon, the Naked Islands, the Dapa. There are a lot of beautiful places in Siargao. So as what she have told me, si Atty. Kanina, na hindi lang surfers ang pumupunta doon. Actually, Siargao is invaded already by foreigners. And a lot of foreigners are there already. So, aside from the training that we give for the homestay, for the hotels, we are now working on the solid waste management system for Siargao, because we don't want to be like Boracay right now, you know. We found out 2 dump sites in Siargao, and we wanted to address it immediately. So that's why DOT initiated this Solid Waste Management Summit to be held this March 15 to 16. It will be attended by different foreign ADB and the World Bank. Also, we also tapped them to participate in our Solid Waste Management, other government agencies to address the solid waste management in Siargao. So nagiging rampant na yung solid waste sa aming lugar. So we initiated that in coordination with the Environmental Management Bureau and the DENR. So we are looking forward to tap some of the communities and municipalities in Siargao to have or to orient them for the awareness of the solid waste management. So that's the DOT role in Siargao, to make it more attractive to all our foreign and local tourists. That's all.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. May we have a gentleman from the back?
Thank you. I'm Michael Angara, police chief from the province of Aurora. I'm the provincial tourism officer. So when I started the program in Baler, way back in 2007, number one product is surfing. So when we started the program, we only had 10,000 tourists in 2007. Last year, we posted around 874,000. We're in 20% of that, 23% to be exact, is surfers. So roughly around 200,000. So the tourism receipt, if you will convert it into peso, around 70 million in the tourism industry, surfing industry alone. So when we started, we only have limited accommodation facilities. We only have almost 45, including the homestay programs. Now we have 300 plus accommodation facilities and can accommodate around 10,000 tourists per rooms per night. So we've been doing this for the past 7 or 8 years. So I would like to share our experience because definitely there are a lot of things to be learned from our programs and mistakes that we did. So it's not all good for the community, and anytime we can share. And if you want data, we can provide data with the 10-year of our, as yearly we have our statistics, we have a survey and everything. And we did this on our own. Syempre, ngayon, DOT will help us. They will train our guides, surf guides. Kasi we have the biggest surfing community. One organization alone, we have 400 members, surfers. So we have three associations. So only one association, we have 400 membership. So you can imagine the scope of how big the surfing industry in Manila right now. So with that, we believe that it's very important with proper planning with DOT. The mistakes that we did can be buffered in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, our representative from Aurora, for sharing your insights from your province. We have Mr. Evangelista.
Good afternoon. My name is Papa Evangelista. I'm from the Department of Tourism. And earlier, some of you, especially Attorney Seri, you mentioned something about DOT promoting. That is correct. I come from the Office of Media Affairs and Public Affairs and Communications. So we basically handle all of promotions of DOT. And it is in our thrust for this year that we will promote sports tourism. So that includes, of course, surfing and other participative sports. Our secretary's mandate for this year, we plan to make the Philippines an international sporting hub. So there are different types of sports. There are leisure sports, participative sports, and like diving and surfing. So some of them, some of these sports are considered for leisure or for entertainment, as you've mentioned earlier. And of course, we're trying to get the different markets. We're trying to get the international market. We're trying to increase our tourist arrivals, but also we want to stimulate domestic tourism. And so maybe with surfing, we can work hand in hand with private stakeholders about surfing and create programs, as what we are actually doing now, and create more programs to really infiltrate and penetrate our the locals and join them. Or encourage them to surf. And you also mentioned about the mistakes earlier. I would just like to note, about two weeks ago, our team went to Boracay. Last year, at the end of 2017, Boracay already hit an all-time high of 2.1 million tourists. So that's the biggest number. And this would account for international and domestic arrivals inside Boracay. And you can only imagine, Boracay is a very small island. And there were two typhoons that ravaged Boracay recently. That's why our team went there. And because of what happened to Boracay a few months ago, because of the typhoon, there was, for the first time, according to the locals, for the first time in 20 years, they never saw flood. They never saw flood, except that time in 20 years. So this is really very alarming. And if we plan to develop some of our areas, especially for surfing, and we want more people to come in to those areas, and as one of our regional directors have said, they're already making plans for solid waste management, etc. Of course, we have to make plans for those as well. And us in the government, in DOT, we are here to support, but And it was also mentioned earlier that we really don't have teeth on apprehending, or you know, it is up to the local government unit to enforce these laws, as our mandate really is just to promote. And we don't want this to happen to our locations. And right now, we are doing all our efforts to save Boracay, because we are already at that time that we have to save Boracay. The DENR, the TIESA, DOT, and some other line agencies, and especially the LGUs, we had a meeting, and we came up with an executive order that we will present to the president. And hopefully, this will be the start of really doing something about our locations. So I would just like to note that with our other areas, Baler, Siargao, La Union, these are prime areas for surfing. And if we do develop them, as we work hand in hand with the local stakeholders and the government, I would just like to note that let us all do our part. And let us all keep that in mind, that too much of it might actually be bad for our beautiful destinations. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We have a question also.
Paul Linzo, I'm the Secretary General of the Philippine Travel Agencies Association. As a practitioner in the industry for the past 40 years, one of the things that we always see that is kind of waste of government funds is that there are so many of the government, especially the DOT training, wherein you know, they encourage everybody to join the training. However, many of them do not finish. That's because it's free. You know, if it is all free, nobody cares about it. You know, you don't have to pay for it. But make sure that you know, the government should have a counterpart fund. So that means to say, if a government's going to be spending 100, then they can also pay 100, so that at least they will know that you know, meron kayong parte dyan. Yes, you have an investment, and you want to have a return for that. Because that's, and the other thing there is, most of these trainings are done on the last quarter of the year. Which is bad, because minamadali. All right. No, so those are the things that we in the market sector have seen that is kind of wasted. That's puro last minute plan. All right. Minamadali. All right. Thank you.
Any other questions from the audience? Yes, ma'am.
Hello. Good afternoon. I'm Gina Barra from LSL College of St. Benilzo. I'm from the Academy. So it's just interesting that we have the local government units, we have the private sector. So this is from the perspective of someone who's teaching tourism. Now, it's actually more of a curious question, and anyone from the panel can answer this. So could there be any collaboration from the between the Academy and probably the Department of Tourism or the local government unit? So just to give you a background, Benilt has a Boracay training center, which will be established by January 2019. So the facility aims to provide trainings to the local community in hospitality management and tourism. So going back to my question, could there be any collaboration between the Academy and LGU or DOT?
That's a good question. I think there's a tremendous amount of potential for collaboration, especially with the baseline data collection and the follow-up. And, you know, the government can do their own data collection too, private sector can, but to have a third party that's hopefully less biased towards some kind of result and just towards science, I think that's the role of the Academy, is just to provide, and if they can do it, to provide valuable data, like, you know, collaborate and see which topics need exploring, which are the priority. I think that's a perfect strategy, a perfect partnership.
Maybe have the Mr. Yvan.
Yeah.
5. Served over 40 breaks in the country, all over the Philippines. And I understand the concerns of the Boracay issue and the Baler issue. I've seen Siargao change. My first time there was 2007. And coming back now, it's really wow. One thing that I picked up from my overseas friends is the concept of putting up what they call surf reserve areas. This surf reserve area is the same concept as what they did in the Underground River in Palawan, where they made a natural park around the Underground River and development was limited. Thus, your kids can enjoy the place the way it was like 100 years ago. Now, this concept of a surf sanctuary is very hard for people who have big interest in the industry, because once we say it's a surf sanctuary, no build zone, keeping it pristine, and there's not much money involved in it. And I'm hoping that the Department of Tourism can actually look into that idea so that we can preserve what little nature is left for the future generations, you know. I've seen all the surf spots change from 5 years, 10 years time, and progress is a very, very powerful entity. You're talking about billions in the interests of people. And I just hope it's not all monetary gain and exploitations of the Philippine coastline. We also look at the environmental, because like what I said, I've tried to serve Cebu in the most polluted way. Trust me, it's not nice. When you paddle, it's just plastic left and right, you know, and it's hazardous to your health, actually. And I'm hoping that we can preserve some of our pristine coastline, not just market, you know, entrepreneurship. If we're gonna do it, sana we can do it in a more balanced way, because if we overdo it, in 5 years' time, sea's gonna be polluted. What's our product? I mean, hopefully we don't forget that we're selling nature, we're selling the sea, not our infrastructure, not our interest. And I'm hoping DOT would also work with DNR, because they're the two agencies leading in that issue. So just that's my 2 cents from surfing over 10 years in the Philippines. I've been to Bali. I've seen how ugly and commercialized it can get. And it's not worth the money. That's all I can say. Once the gubat, once the sea is changed, it's hard to rebuild it. And kawawa the future generations if they can't get to experience it in real life, you know, all these here pictures, you know. And I'm hoping we can change the direction of progress to a more healthier, they call it progress, but sometimes too much progress is going backwards. So just 2 pieces, thank you.
I'll add to that because it's an interesting input. Since Region 13 is here, and I know you're probably talking to the governor, they're not planning of doing a development authority similar to the Laguna Lake Development Authority. I came from the DNR, I know what the structure is. The more you pollute, the more money for LMDA, because that's their source of income from the polluters paying principle. So if you make that decision, you have to also be strongly looking at it, because there are several models of tourism. I like the model of Bhutan. Bhutan is primarily doing nature tourism. But in terms of poverty, you know, they're not exactly poor. Why? They came in with a tourism model where it's so expensive to get in Bhutan.
Yeah.
And yet a lot of those millionaires are going to Bhutan. And Bhutan is sustaining itself through tourism because of these millionaires, billionaires going to Bhutan, because they're making it more of a prestige to be able to go to Bhutan. I don't see any of that model in the Philippines.
that's actually, it's a low-impact visit, which is ideal for nature conservation, and that could be Siargao. And that's easier even for the tourist operators because you only have to deal with 10 people. Pero, by the way, they're pound divas. But still, you're only talking 10 divas. That's a model you want to look at. We're digressing on tourism. Okay, I want to go back to her presentation. There's a disconnect. Surf tourism, no crowds. Go to GL, everyone's there. How about the other areas who are also exactly as poor as San Benito and as other areas? So that's the role of DOT to look at. You cannot just keep on promoting. When you promote Siargao, you show the surf. And yet, you're only talking to 4% of the arrivals. So in terms of infrastructure, it's an interesting discussion. And I just want to say to the tour operators on how influential your voice is to all of this. You know, how you can actually influence the way local government, because they listen. It's true they lack awareness. Believe me, the reason why Siargao is becoming to be almost lost is they don't know what's coming. You know, I'm just glad that the existing mayor, even if he's much criticized, he's been mayor for 30 years now. 30 years. He even refused to have his roads paved. Initially, he wants the roads to be dealt way. He wants it the way when he was growing up, then suddenly the roads came because DOT promoted it and there's a need to do infrastructure. We're now seeing tourist arrivals that Siargao cannot even accommodate. But I'm not being critical here, I was just saying, I'm just taking this opportunity for everyone to see that the Philippines can be a leader in tourism and that Dr. Porter can probably validate that in Southeast Asia. The top 10 tourist arrivals, Bangkok, Thailand is number one. Why? What's in Bangkok? The sweet mango? What is it? So, why is Bangkok number one? And in the top 10, there are only Asia, two Asian countries. Others is Singapore. They don't even have resources. We're sitting on a gem and don't know what to do with it. Maybe that's the problem. Too much riches. Don't know how to spend it in the context of ecotourism. So, ecotourism, other kinds of models, no. It doesn't mean it's cheap. It's good. So let's have some model that we might want to explore, and tourist and the DOT would be the right agency to do that.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Benji Sanchado. I am also a regional director of Region 5 that's in Bicol, and in Bicol we have three surfing destinations which are becoming popular. One is intermediate, the other one is advanced, and the other one is a beginner. I'd like first to comment on the comment made by my friend Paul. Paul, tama ka doon, marami kaming activities, upunta yun kasi libre. After that, wala naman nangyayari. It has to do with political at the start because we are grounded in the regions and we try to balance always things with the local government unit. That's the first one. Nahihirapan kami in the sense that, you know, the tourism officers are not even permanent. To develop a project or a destination, we need a permanent tourism personnel to handle it, and that it takes time to develop. Alam niya naman ang mga tourism officers. Secondly, we're trying to correct up all yung ano, mga last quarter activities. So in our department, in our unit, in our DRCRG, we are not trying to balance all these things. That's why we are now more aggressive on those things. And the third one, in comment, yeah, we are now trying to develop the ecotourism which is sustainable in the sense that we're trying to balance the quality and sustainability of the destinations that we're trying to do now. My purpose of coming over is to learn more about your experiences because we're trying to develop. We cannot say we, because we just, we have to move the numbers. We are kolela in arrivals in the ASEAN region, whether we like it or not. So you will say, what happened? We have more beautiful destinations, we have more warm people, and yet we are only ASEAN countries, I think we are the fifth. And we are being overtaken by Vietnam, by Cambodia, which are way, way down during the past years. So even DOT is reinventing where we do wrong. So we make more promotions, we make more discovering these new destinations, these new products, so that perhaps we can invite and increase our tourism arrivals. So I'm here for those reasons. And true enough, we have to strengthen the partnership of the LGU. We have to strengthen the partnership with the private stakeholders and the community where the products are there. So dialogue. So now we're trying now to make things right. First, before we go there and develop the area, we talk to the local government unit. Make a local tourism development plan, not an activity, because you see a potential destination. You have to make a plan. And then second, we engage now the community if they like the product. Because at the end of the day, we'd like to elevate also, because most of the destinations in the provinces are, tama kayo, Dr. Porter, they are poor regions. And these are the only things that we can set, actually, by the way. So we tell the community, we ask for support, and then we let the stakeholders come and talk. So it will take some time. And the problem is, if the product will take some time to develop and be promoted, if there's a new administration that comes in that does not support tourism, then we have to redo all over again. And by the way, the regional directors are also changed every 6 years. So those are the things that we are, so balance to us is also very important. But nonetheless, we're taking all of these your observations in our notes so that we can discuss this also in our meetings with the directors. We meet regularly. And for the benefit of everyone, we in the DOT are doing all our what we can do to really push, because we are really would like to help in the economic growth of the country to our own little way. And mind you are asking a lot, but our budget is only the second lowest in the budget in the entire agency of the government. So in the regions, some regions like hers has only 13 staff. I only have 20. So Herculean job for us, and we don't have provincial offices. So napakahirap talaga these things and the limited budget. But we're trying to do, because we made a commitment to help the country. The reasons why the other regions, I've talked with some tourism practitioners. DOT, their tourism is above all the other agencies. Hindi yung DOT nasa ibaba. Sila ang nagmamandate, sila nag-uutos sa Department of Public Works, nagawin itong kalsada, pupunta doon sa destination na ito. Ganyan, ganyan. So you can see now the disparity. Maybe because, kaya nga, maybe we're not improving because we're way down, kulang budget. So everybody understand. And let's work together to attain this. Maybe we can come up with something, working together. And thank you, Dr. Porter, because you confirmed all observations that ecotourism will be a way to go, and there has to be a balance. Yung mga sinasabi. I hope you understand that one. It's in Tagalog. Thank you very much.
One thing that came up in our data, specific to surf tours, was the idea of value for money. And I think that's where the Philippines struggles to compete a lot of times. It's not that people are fine paying a lot of money, but it's just feeling like it was valuable and that it was an easy experience. And I think Southeast Asia is very competitive in that. And if you go somewhere, Indonesia, Vietnam, Thailand, these places have tourism wired. They're very willing to cater to tourists. And I speak as an outsider and a vegetarian. It's very difficult to order vegetarian meals in the Philippines. I finally figured it out. But little things like that, it makes the experience a little more challenging. Like if I ask, can I have chicken pansi without chicken? No, ma'am. Okay, can I have chicken pansi? No chicken? Sure. And it took me, 2 years to figure out the strategy. You just order what you want, know this. But you know, I struggled for years picking stuff out of what I want. So little things like that, just giving a quality experience, and I think it comes back to education and training. So.
Thank you, Dr. Barker. So unfortunately, yeah, we only need one last question from Ms. Harris.
I actually don't have a question.
Okay.
Some people show.
Okay, so.
Wow, I'm the last one to talk. No, I hope not. It's not a question, but thank you very much for giving me the opportunity. I'm from Zamblewood, and Zamblewood is a social enterprise. It is a social enterprise because we're addressing giving employment to people with disabilities. So people go there because, I mean, people like the disabilities, people with disabilities go there as a venue for OJT. I like very much what you said about Bhutan, Attorney Sereen, because as a resort, we're 3 years old, we do not advertise. It's purely word of mouth, so please look for Zamblewood in Facebook. But the people who go there are very hungry for sanctuary, for natural experiences. You go there, our roads are not paved. We have the forest, we have the lake, we have the beach, of course we have mountains to backing us. But people always feel that they have taken a holiday. And people, when they ask about our location, they say, oh, what can we do there? And I say, you go there to disconnect and reconnect from within. So it is so true that this is what people are looking for now, especially with, you know, a generation of gadgets. They actually go to some place where they long to just be with nature. So we are, you know, ecotourism in that respect. And we have two types of accommodation. We have the Julian Surf Indy. By the way, the reason why we are a venue for people with disabilities is because it's a very personal mission for me. My son has autism, and that one is a location where my son can have a place for employment, a place for purpose. And so we cater to two types of clientele. We have people who can afford to pay for the piece, and we also have the Julian Surf B&B, which is for the millennials. But it's the same, we offer the same piece for everyone, and we do have surfing as well. So really what I just want to say is, like Bhutan, Philippines is so beautiful. You know, we have so much to offer. Not have to build a touristy place. People just come to see how beautiful our natural resources is. And with that in mind, we can really do it. So that's all that I want to share. Thank you.
I would just like to add something, not to what Ms. Zamblewood said. I guess we all talked about like government doing something to improve the locations. What I'm trying to say is that it's not enough that the government, only the government will act. I'm gonna throw this to all the tourism practitioners, like doing trips, doing holidays, bringing people to the locations to have this mindset to properly educate those people that you would bring to the locations on what's in there and what not to do and what not to bring and what not to throw away when they arrive. In that way, not only that the government would have an easier job of developing the or slowing down the destruction or the damage that the visitors are doing, but it would also bring a proper mindset to. Or it would spark a culture of properly managing our natural resources. That's all.
So thank you. So finally, for just a quick question, right from Diego.
I am Joante from TIESA under Tourism Enterprise Zone Management Sector. So I'll just be quick. This is not a question, but it's information for everyone. Actually, right now, in Bocas Grande, Socorro, the Comprehensive Tourism Master Plan has just been approved. So we will conduct a stakeholders meeting after we finalize the Comprehensive Tourism Master Plan. And Siargao has an ongoing master planning. Maybe it will take a year, but hopefully it finishes as soon as possible. And then lastly, especially for the local government units that are here, we currently entertain requests for technical assistance for consultancy services in tourism master planning. So what you can do, if your municipality has no comprehensive tourism master plan yet, you can collaborate or coordinate with the regional director, the DOT regional director, to endorse your municipality and write letter and concept paper to COO Pocholo J. Paragas so we can help you with the technical assistance for the service. So that's all.
Okay, so thank you for that. Before I finally close the question and answer portion, may I ask our panelists and our speaker to share some kind of words for the audience.
Nothing much to say, but we're friends now after that. But you know, this is a good exercise, and we hope we can do more.
For the DOT, although one of the major functions or mandate of the DOT is promotion, but then one important mandate of course also of the DOT is to do the regulation and then the standards. So the DOT is here not only to promote our destinations product, but the DOT is also here to ensure that we can provide quality facilities and services to our tourists, either domestic or international.
Last words again. Proper education really helps alleviate that is already being done.
Closing remarks. I think the Philippines, it's been said over and over again, it's has so many natural resources. It's a gorgeous place. And it's just this idea of managing it well, looking at the long-term benefits, not the short-term gains. Yeah, community can get rich really quickly, they develop fast, but then it's over once it's ruined. So it's looking at this, you know, instead of a 5-year plan, a 30-year plan, and seeing generations ahead. And that'll be critical to keeping everything sustainable.
So finally, I'll be closing this question and answer portion. However, if you have other questions for our panelists and speaker, feel free to approach them after the program. This has been truly a very productive discussion. Now, one of the important takeaways from this discussion is the potential of surf tourism as a niche market in the country. Although we mentioned a while ago that there are benefits that can be gained from the industry, on the one hand, it also poses challenges, as you highlighted in some of the questions and concerns that we have. And what has become apparent in this discussion is the fact that institutions, mechanisms, and policies must be in place. There is a need to further understand what development means and what it entails in terms of tourism. And at the end of the day, it's really about cooperation and development among participants, among value chain members in this industry, to ensure that surfing does not only leave surfers and visitors satisfied, euphoric, and stoked, but also help lift the lives of people in the communities around here. So once again, it's been a pleasure to moderate today's discussion, and I would like to thank our speaker and our panelists, and of course, everyone who has contributed to this discussion. So before I end, I would like to formally move on to the program. I will transmit on to the program.
Okay, so before we proceed with the last portions of the program, may I call the Executive Director of the Andrew Tan Center for Tourism, Professor Fernando Rojas, and the Chair of the Basan and Sarala Birla Professorial Chair for Asian Family Corporation, Professor Andrea Santiago for an awarding with the World Experience Philippines
Short background, Juliet was one of the graduates of the first developing and design sustainable tourism programs together with Ofel and Reggie. Her experience as a social entrepreneur so moved us that we wrote, Professor Jeannie and I wrote a case about her, what she's doing for the community, slum communities in then Smoky and then in Paseco. And this case, which we will use in the programs in AIM, actually won a prize, the CIMA case competition that was done or was held in China. So we got the prize, and in turn, we'd like to donate that prize money to Juliet's organization. Firstly, of course.
This is not the real check, right? The real check is with her.
It's funny because I don't do anything in surfing. Our scope of business is rural tourism. So I'm the founder of Smoky Tours. We do slum tours. So there are a lot of people who want to see the other side of Manila, and that's what we're doing. We educate poor people to become professional tour leaders. And besides our slum tour, we have a market tour, a family tour, a bicycle tour, and a cemetery tour. And the money of our slum tour goes back to the community. So at this point, we're managing a health center in Paseco. And yeah, that's what we do. So it was really nice, and I was touched by Jeannie and Nani to visit us and to be so enthusiastic to put everything on paper, because it's really hard. It's not easy to be a social entrepreneur, and it's hard also to stay with your core and your passion. And if you're working with poor people, then you're working with poor communities. But every day I still look in the mirror and think, okay, we're creating awareness. And it makes me really, really happy. I want to thank AIM to put it on paper, right? So we can be an example for others. We can educate and empower others. So if everyone wants to know anything, please don't hesitate to ask. But thank you very much from the bottom of our heart.
So thank you, Ms. Juliet. The story of World Experience is really inspiring. So finally, we are now to proceed with the awarding of certificates of appreciation and tokens to our resource speakers and panelists. May I call on once again the Executive Director and Associate Director of the AAM, Dr. Andrew Allan Center for Tourism, for the awarding. So the AAM Dr. Andrew Allan Center for Tourism awards the certificate of appreciation to Miss Marian Obispo of the Department of Tourism for being one of the panelists in the lecture of Surf Tourism and Social Entrepreneurship in Bozo. So may I request Dr. Porter and the panelists for a photo op. Mm-hmm.
we would like to call in our executive director for some closing remarks.
Okay, thank you very much to all our friends who braved the Makati traffic to join us here this afternoon. To our distinguished participants and guests, on behalf of the AIM, Dr. Andrew Tan Center for Tourism, I would like to begin by expressing my sincerest gratitude to everyone, most especially to our distinguished speaker, Dr. Brooke Porter, and our discussants, Marian Obispo, Joey Cornelio, and Attorney Serene. Your presence and active participation have made this event truly meaningful for all of us. Today's lecture series on surf tourism and social entrepreneurship in local communities focus on the significance of the role of surf tourism in achieving sustainable tourism development. This lecture has brought together academicians, industry stakeholders to discuss the trends, practices, opportunities, and challenges in surf tourism, with the hope of strengthening the tourism community's commitment in driving sustainability in the industry and for all Filipinos. In looking forward, our center will continue to pursue sustainable tourism development in the Philippines. We will continue our efforts delivering quality information and educational programs in tourism management. We hope to see you again, along with new friends and partners, this great endeavor in the next forum. Thank you once again. Good day to all of you.